What's going on, everyone? I'm Jaren, and today we are talking about The Exorcism. This story follows a troubled actor who begins to exhibit disruptive behavior while shooting a horror film. His estranged daughter begins to wonder if he's slipping back into his past addictions or if something more sinister is at play. Now, when I first caught wind that Russell Crowe was going to be doing another Exorcism movie, I was stunted. I thought to myself, wow, they're really pushing out all these sequels to The Pope's Exorcist already when that movie only came out last year. And it turns out this was a different kind of Exorcism movie, which was actually back in production before The Pope's Exorcist back in 2019, I believe. And they finished this movie. It ended up on some studio's shelf collecting dust. And then they just decided to release it this year. I mean, honestly, I would really love another Pope's Exorcist movie. But I mean, if he truly is in his Exorcism era doing these kind of movies, we just need one more for his unofficial trilogy. Now, this is coming from the same creative team who is responsible for 2015's The Final Girls, and I've been dying to see what more they could do in Hollywood. Heck, I also just found out that the writer-director Joshua John Miller is Jason Miller's son, the actor who played Father Damien Karras of the 1973 The Exorcist and the William Peter Blatty's Exorcist 3. I mean, it was only fitting that the director was just meant to do a story like this, where Hollywood wanted to do a remake of The Exorcist. Yes, the film itself, but when you watch the movie, they're going to refer to it as the Georgetown Project due to copyright laws. Starting off with the positives, I honestly was not expecting anything good to come out from this movie based off the trailer, but I was wrong. I actually enjoyed the performances. They were pretty solid. I mean, Russell Crowe, man, he did not phone it in. He could have given us half the effort, but fortunately, he really just wears a lot of his pain and struggle on top of his sleeves. He's a washed-up actor who is trying to make a big comeback, especially in his career after the loss of a loved one, after coming back from recovery of drugs and alcohol abuse. The Georgetown Project being one of the very big gigs and big roles he's had in such a very long time, you can see that he has trouble with his memory, just memorizing lines, as well as taking on the role of a priest, which is a very heavy subject about his past. Seeing that this is not the first movie to deal with a possessed protagonist, I really wish Russell Crowe got to have a little bit more fun in the role. I mean, take for example Anthony Hopkins in The Rite. When it comes to the third act, he really commands the screen iconically. And here, I just wish that we got to revel in the terror just a little bit longer, push the envelope. I mean, we do get Russell Crowe with the unnerving behavior and goes absolutely bonkers in the later half. I mean, I just wish there were more times that I was actually scared of Russell Crowe. I mean, one or two times he had me jump in my seat, but other than that, I thought that the possessed demonic one-liner he gets really had me cracking up, and that seemed to be more that kind of stuck with me the most. When Russell Crowe's daughter first steps into frame, I was like, is that Dalton from Insidious? No, it can't be. This is a girl. And it turns out that this is Ryan Simpkins. She's the sister of Ty Simpkins, and you know, she's like the second oldest of the family. It looks like these kids just love acting, and they're all in the family. They love horror. And I was really nervous at first, because I haven't seen much of her work, that she wasn't going to be able to hold her own when it came to acting alongside Russell Crowe, and she turned out, surprisingly, to be the heart of the film. I really dug her performance. And I am very, very, very thankful that as the estranged daughter who is trying so hard to accept her father back into her life, she did not play off the rebellious and angsty teenager all the way through. When the going gets tough, she is not as dismissive, and she is very open to the possibility that something nefarious is afoot, and she really tries to aid our main character when he is in distress. You guys already know that I love movies about making movies, so although the supernatural aspect of this film does take a much longer approach to start picking up steam. I was fully invested by just the production of this pseudo Exorcist remake, especially with the way that they laid out the main stage, and it looks like an open dollhouse, which was kind of cool. And then we have the cold room, as they call it, where the main stage, the exorcism, the bedroom scene, so to speak, would take place, and they would give off that blue hue, the visible cold breath that you would see from our actors, because it's basically a refrigerator. There's also the special and practical effects involving this little glitch of an animatronic, which I thought would have been a cool opportunity to tinker with. And then we have Adam Goldberg, who was a perfect casting choice as the director. I mean, the man was a prick, but I mean, he really adds his own punch to provocation. And one of my favorite lines that he says, which kind of describes not only the movie that they're making, but the movie that we're, as the audience, are watching, is, "It's a psychological drama wrapped up in a horror movie." Perfect. Moving on to my more mixed opinions, although you have all the ingredients and tropes to make an effective supernatural horror thriller, I thought these guys kind of played this movie pretty safe. And that's only because, with other than the language, like a few frames of blood could have easily been left out on the cutting room floor and it would have made a passable PG-13 film. This also includes the demon that they're up against and the purpose of their evil, but we will get into that in my negatives. Sam Worthington is in this movie and I really feel sad and sorry for the guy, because if he is not starring in his next big Avatar movie, he is making these thankless appearances in movies where he could get like third or fourth billing, but he's got like 3 to 5 scenes that are no longer than 2 minutes each. Getting into my negatives, I think this movie was undercooked. I really think they could have used a MacGuffin, a reason as to why this particular demon was targeting those who were playing the priest of this movie. And I don't know if there was someone on set that was some kind of witch causing this to happen. I wasn't sure whether it was just a flat-out cursed production, or why this particular demon was going after the actors and killing the actors who were trying to play the priest, Father Arlington. I mean, not a real threat. I mean, if a real priest was on set, you figured they would just kill that one particular character, one done and bang. And then by the time we get to the final act, the exorcism, I felt like that final blow was just a flash and fizzle, and I personally don't think they got rid of that demon completely. But I still prefer to watch this third act over The Exorcist Believer, if that means anything. Last but not least, the demon that makes its malevolence present is a particular god that is associated with sacrificing children. And as you can see throughout the movie, there was no child in sight. There were no children to sacrifice. There was nowhere near them moving onto a path where they were going to explore those darker themes. I mean, take for example, Sinister. That has something to do with children and a fucking demon. But this felt like the wrong demon in the wrong movie. If anything, this demon was more of a troublemaker who really enjoyed flickering lights, which happens a lot. And turns out they like playing host in Russell Crowe's body throughout the entire production. I mean, kill everyone else, but possess Russell Crowe. Overall, this wasn't terrible. I thought it was enjoyable, entertaining. I think they missed an opportunity to have Brad Dourif as part of this movie. I think that would have really added on for a more compelling performance, as well as a kick-ass ending. I just find it funny that a movie about making an Exorcist remake is a lot more pleasant for me than watching a sequel to The Exorcist. And I do think that Russell Crowe has a better screen presence as Father Amorth in The Pope's Exorcist by a mile, but this wasn't a bad watch. Alright guys, that's all I get to share about that movie. Go ahead and check it out if you want. I don't think it's playing in theaters anymore, but if it is playing in a theater near you, go ahead and check it out if you don't have anything else. And otherwise, it's going to be streaming on Shudder real soon. Thank you guys for taking some time out of your day to hear me talk some movies. I know I've been really late on these reviews, but bear with me. I've had a lot going on. It's been really tiring and just been tough. It's been tough times, especially during this summer. But look forward to those reviews, and I will see you guys at the theater. In the meantime, take care.